Our government held more than 49,000 children at detention shelters last year, separated from their families.
For some, their parents crossed illegally and got deported, with no guarantee they'll ever be reunited.
The KVU Defenders and our Border Bureau team show how a Central Texas family fights to make a difference. Here's investigative reporters Erica Proffer and Oscar Margain.
Wendy.
You could call Wendy Sewell.
You want to show her all the pictures you've been drawing?
A blooming artist.
Yeah. That's mommy. That is.
But behind these works
rainbow.
Is a deeper connection.
Where's Byron in this picture?
Oh, right there.
Byron is a 9-year-old boy from Guatemala, a boy Wendy has only met on the phone.
You put little hearts. That's so cute.
Cute?
What is that in the middle?
To Wendy.
That in the middle, a heart?
This is a doorway into her home.
Because I love him?
As soon as the zero tolerance policy was put into place, there are so many children that were separated.
Little water.
Instead of giving money to an organization.
Dad is a star.
What could we actually do to help the situation?
Holly Sewell wanted to do something big.
So this is where we are right here. How about it? Do you remember?
We started talking about what we wanted to have happen to our children.
All the way down here is where he's from.
Something with heart.
We would want a safe family to take them in and treat them like they're one of their own.
Wendy and her brother Desmond are 5 and 8.
Oh man, she's gonna ham it up.
So any child brought here would need to be their age.
There was no mechanism in place at all for us to help in that way.
So a friend recommended talking with an attorney.
And he told me about Byron.
That attorney also put Holly in touch with Byron's dad, David.
This is me asking for you.
He fled Guatemala after gangs beat him for his evangelical Christian beliefs.
Looks like it's gonna keep going.
They threatened Byron.
Oh, and there's a photo of Byron right there that he just sent.
He crossed the U.S. border illegally and faced federal charges in McAllen, Texas.
4045, David, Zoe, Tremont, please stand up.
It's adorable.
Sir, do you have anything you want to say on your behalf?
Doesn't look like their house.
Si es que si me van a deportar.
I don't know where that is.
Es el único hijo que tengo que me lo han quitado. Deseo que me lo regresen.
He's a cutie pie.
David was deported. Byron was not. The Office of Refugee Resettlement, or ORR, is in charge of separated children.
It's the beginning of October that they denied us. The one thing they said was that we didn't have a prior relationship with him before he migrated.
Their rule, this policy here, this 2.2.4, says any sponsor must be a relative or have a prior relationship with a separated child. Neither of which description belongs to Holly and her family.
All we wanted was to be vetted.
Byron's attorney, Ricardo De Anda, sued ORR, claiming the government agency violated prior court agreements and didn't give Byron due process, among other violations.
The private interest at issue here is this child's freedom. It is legal to ask for asylum in this country, and so he is in this country legally.
ORR said their policy, that 2.2.4 rule, was for child safety.
Certainly the right of the parent to choose what's in his child's best interest is a paramount right. That's why we're before this court. The parents chose Holly Sewell and her family.
Do you know who I'm talking to right now, Wendy? Hmm? I'm talking to David.
The court ordered ORR to consider Holly and her family.
Do you remember who David is?
Byron's dad?
Yeah.
2 weeks passed.
Byron! Oh my goodness. Oh, Tavo.
Byron!
So excited. Remember Wendy? Look at our doggy. Wendy, Des, and Matthew. Be Matthew. You guys want to give hugs?
Mom.
How you feeling? All my Spanish just went away.
Byron spent 10 months in detention. He had a birthday with no celebration.
Muy felices.
And you probably already noticed Byron's leg is broken. That happened in detention, too. Nurses wrapped his ankle. 3 days passed before a doctor realized Byron broke his femur.
¿Está bien si vamos todos o quieres nomás ir con Holly?
Todos.
Before Byron left the airport lot.
Hola, David.
David also celebrated the day and shared the excitement.
Let's go home and relax. Bump. Bump. Ooh. Ha ha, we did it. Bienvenido.
Bienvenido.
Wendy also welcomed each new minute.
So welcoming.
Our little hostess.
Byron's room, while fit for a kid, shows he's experienced what only adults should know. Long journeys, separation, being stuck.
¿Tienes hambre?
Sí. We've got some food for everybody, too.
First time he's had Texas barbecue.
I'm doing this because it's the right thing to do.
Byron's pro bono attorney, Ricardo De Onda, says he has other clients like Byron.
Byron's case, I think, is going to open the floodgates.
Clients who have parents deported, like David, who rely on the kindness of others.
Ya con la familia de Holly, ya nos sentimos más seguros de que él va a tener esa... Esa salud, esos sentimientos de niño, pues, pidiéndole a Dios que nos ayude por la ausencia de Byron, por la salud que nosotros tenemos y por todo eso.
Byron's bedroom door shows the sponsor family's values, but you don't need to know English to see their heart.
Byron wasn't sent back because of that threat on his life. David, in Guatemala, has an asylum case pending here in the U.S. If granted, he will be united with Byron. If denied, Byron may get approved separately or sent back to Guatemala. Their attorney hopes this opens more sponsorship. So many other children don't have that chance. Here's Oscar Margain.
Byron's story is unique, and so are the stories of thousands of unaccompanied migrant children who remain in government custody across the country. The debate here is how to best care for migrant children. That is, after all, what the law demands. In 2008, Congress ordered the Department of Health and Human Services, which includes the Office of Refugee Resettlement, to promptly place a minor in the, quote, least restrictive setting that is in the best interest of the child, end quote. And the least restrictive setting, according to the American Academy of Pediatrics, is an actual home with an actual family, given it's deemed safe.
In the case of Office of Refugee Resettlement, you have children who don't have a buffering adult that they know and love with them. So although those conditions are more child-friendly, we would argue that children would be served best in the community when they're in the care of a sponsor who loves them.
Dr. Linton argues that the longer a child spends away from a loving adult, the more detrimental it is to his or her development.
Toxic stress is serious prolonged stress in the absence of the buffering support of a parent or guardian or some other stable adult figure.
And as the number of unaccompanied migrant children crossing the border continues to rise, the longer it takes for ORR to find suitable sponsors. The average time to place a child with a sponsor has gone from 60 days in 2018 to 66 in 2019. 32,000 minors have been referred to HHS between October and March. That's about a 50% jump compared to last year when the zero tolerance policy and the migrant family separations took place. Focus on the government's ability to care for children has increased after the death of four Guatemalans in the last 6 months.
I think it becomes incredibly difficult to be able to handle the numbers that are coming in a way that is compassionate.
Advocates argue that opening up the sponsorship program to other willing families who are not relatives, which is at the heart of Byron's case, may allow for quicker placement.
We have 15, 16, 17-year-olds that are in detention, and their parents want them to stay in the U.S. because it's a better life for them. And they have the right to be in the U.S., but they can't find any sponsors because they have no relatives in the U.S.
The government, however, argues that the policy limiting sponsorships to familial relationships is for the protection of the child.
It's meant to encourage genuine sponsorships and mitigate the risk of releasing unaccompanied minors to human trafficking.
Now, whether Byron's case will provoke a change in ORR policy, we're yet to find out. Repeated requests to HHS for comment have gone unanswered. Now, Deanda and Dr. Linton believe that each one of these migrant children deserve, at the very least, legal representation in order to have a fair shot at a life here in the U.S. According to the Executive Office for Immigration Review, 35% of all unaccompanied migrant children have to represent themselves in court. In a joint assignment with the KVU Defenders, I'm Oscar Morgane reporting in Los Indios near the Texas-Mexico border.
The stories aren't always like Byron and his dad, David. Last month, Homeland Security investigators spoke with about 100 families. They didn't release the exact number, but said fraud was in more than a quarter of the cases, specifically people posing as a family unit. Families are housed differently. They're processed differently. Because of prior court rulings, families often get released while their immigration case works through the courts. Homeland Security investigators say fake families are big business.
We've also encountered children who were provided to strangers just for the purpose of coming across as a family unit, a fraudulent family unit.
They were provided from their parents?
Yes.
To the strangers?
Yes.
Extra investigators went across the southwest border, but here's where they went in Texas. You have El Paso there on the western end and Harlingen in the Rio Grande Valley. These teams will have criminal and document analysts, as well as forensic interview specialists and victim assistance specialists. Also, Immigration and Customs Enforcement sent 330 extra deportation officers to the border. For the KVU Defenders, Erica Proffer, KVU News.